The Hunter Valley's building industry is in a better position than most other areas in the state. Although it has been depressed in recent months, there has been a slight improvement, which Mr. Steep says means that the building industry is on the road to recovery.
Well, I think we're in a much better position than most of the other areas, because you must take into account the inflated boom we had in the 1980-81 period, and when I check some figures today along the basis of these releases, we are now operating at approximately the 1978 level, which after all was a reasonable situation to be in. I think probably this region would be far better off at the present moment than most other parts of the country, and I hope that if this 0.5 increase from March to April continues, that we might now see an upward trend.
Heart disease is the number one cause of death in Australia. In the Hunter region, some 1,000 people died from heart-related diseases in the past year. But as people have become more aware of the risk factors involved, they have modified their lifestyles accordingly. Dr. Steve Leader and his team from the University of Newcastle are investigating these changes by surveying some 2,000 people in an effort to pinpoint the successful methods.
We've had quite an encouraging downturn in the number of deaths from heart disease over the last 10 years, about a 25% decline, which is pretty good news. And what we're aiming to do is to try to find out what it is that we're doing well that's bringing that change about.
And how are you doing it?
In this particular study, we're having a look at the frequency of certain factors in the community that we believe predispose to heart disease, like high blood pressure, high cholesterol. And we're making measurements of these factors now with a view to measuring the trends in them over the next 10 years. So
in her statement ruling out an enforced amalgamation in Newcastle, Senator Ryan called for resource sharing, not only between the college and the university, but with the city's technical colleges as well. Executives from both institutions received the statement with delight, saying resource sharing is a good idea, and that all three organisations stand to benefit from it. They are, however, disappointed that they haven't been granted extra funds. Apparently, their funding levels were lowered when the merger was imminent. Another aspect of the statement, which does concern some members of staff, is the mention of a review to be carried out in 1985 by the Commonwealth Tertiary Education Commission. It was that body that recommended the amalgamation to both the Fraser government and the new Labor government, and some fear that in 1985 the Commission may renew its bid to have Newcastle's University and CAE merged.
The Tertiary Education Commission's nose must be very much out of joint. It gave bad advice after the Razor Gang's decision. It really went back on its own recommendations. It attempted deliberately to sabotage advanced education here in Newcastle, and we've got plenty of evidence to support that. They tried to persuade the new government that it should go ahead with amalgamation, and I've no doubt that it will continue to try to give that kind of advice.
This is the old Gosford Police Station in Mann Street. It's so old that local member Mr. Brian McGowan has asked that it be covered by an historic building preservation order. The police accommodation problem on the Central Coast was recognised back in 1971 when the then Premier, Robert Askin, first promised a new building, but it's taken until now to become a reality. The opening was full of the usual razzmatazz, with the speeches, distinguished guests and flag raising. and no official opening is complete without the unveiling of the plug. The new station was made possible under a leasing policy pioneered this year. The building was originally earmarked for office space, but was soon converted after it was announced that police would be the tenants. Closed circuit television has been installed. This provides the building with an advanced security system monitored at all times. And of course, such things as the charge room and cells had to be provided when the conversions were carried out. A sophisticated communications room also went on display today, complete with two-way radio, special telephones and telex. But most important, the new station gives officers room to move, something they've not had for many years.
RSL and Country Club. The club was opened today by its president, Mr. Charlie Nonagan, in the presence of the Mayor of Lake Macquarie, Alderman Jeff Pasterfield, representatives from the Returned Servicemen's League, and about 1,000 enthusiastic members. Some of the facilities the club provides are a 50-seat restaurant, pool and darts room, members' bar, and a 500-seat auditorium. The president says the club is destined to be a focal point for entertainment and sport in the area.
Because we're on the telly, right? Right, where we go? Come on, hurry up, join in! Good, that's better. Come on, basic skills. Get it up in the air. Let's hear you talking. Good lad. Good lad, well done. Get it going again. Talk to each other.
We're badging up.
My ball!
Well, these lads are probably a little bit older than some of the children I've been coaching here, and I think that I'm just getting them down to basic skills, which is passing. I think the game's all about passing and giving themselves a bit of space, because what happens, they all tend to crowd to the ball, you know? But if they can pull away, I mean, it's very hard to tell them. They're enjoying themselves, after all, and that's what it's all about. If they keep enjoying themselves, well, I think they'll improve anyway. But if I can just help them a little bit, if they give themselves a little bit of space, I think they'll probably enjoy the game a lot more, they'll have a lot more of the ball, and I think that they'll definitely improve on that.
Obviously, there are problems in terms of numbers, and particularly of ensuring that the product of any course, the graduates of these courses, in fact, are competent clinical practitioners, whether they are practicing in a hospital or in the community, and therefore an institution which is basically an educational institution has to be very sure that the competencies of practice are of a high standard. And that's probably the major area of our concern, is how do we ensure that smooth transition between theory learnt in a classroom and actual practice in the clinical field.
Thank you.
My principal interest is the National Highway, and certainly we want him to ensure that we are constructing in the right level of progress, that we are giving priority to those sections that need to be done first, and to ensure that there's value for money in the work that's being done for the Australian taxpayers.
How do the roads in this district compare to those in other regions?
We've got very special problems here, particularly on the west side of the lake. They're associated with coal carriage. That's in one area. In the major national highway itself, there's an urgent need to complete the Sydney Newcastle Expressway as soon as possible. Then again, to the north of Newcastle, roads associated with coal movements need to be upgraded. So overall, we've got a very, very difficult set of problems, and that's why we want to have the best information available. We want to be able to plan it properly. We want to get it done as soon as we can.
At last night's meeting, which was held behind closed doors at the rugby club, members voted overwhelmingly against a motion to close the club and cease trading from June the 30th. Instead, the club will continue on for the moment, and a small committee has been formed to advise club management on the next steps to be taken to minimise future trading losses. The club has been hit by random breath testing, among other things. President, Mr. Michael Rogers, was pleased with last night's response to the crisis talks.
Had a fairly good roll-up of members, and although the members voted against the motion, they were quite adamant on the opinion that they have, that they want the club to continue operating.
And what of the future of the club?
If we get a similar response to tonight's meeting in the future, I think the club will prosper, but we may have to reduce our hours to do so.
But you do feel that the club will remain open?
Yes, definitely.
For her first venture as a director, Deborah Jones chose Howard Brenton's play Revenge because she thought a good result was achievable, and she certainly has achieved her aim. Although it started a little slowly, the cast soon got into stride and took every opportunity from Brenton's very lively script. The play tells of the fanatic criminal Adam Heppel and his conflict with Assistant Police Commissioner McLeish, who, according to criminal legend, was the first to say, "Are you coming quietly?" Along the way, the playwright touches on many subjects, but his main theme is the breakdown of the traditionally clear lines between the law enforcers and the criminal class. It's becoming harder and harder to tell the goodies from the baddies. The cast of six, some taking extra roles, carried out their tasks well, all giving solid performances. The cold, fearful menace which the playwright intended at the start of the show was not there. The interaction between the criminal characters was more of the petty villainy of Minder than the hardened desperation of the Sweeney. After this uncertain beginning, the cast, crew and director should be well pleased with Revenge in the green room at the University Great Hall until Sunday.
Broadmeadow and Port Waratah-based loco drivers met at Adamstown for 2 hours this morning to listen to reports on the dispute and decide on future action. Similar meetings were held in Sydney and at major country centres throughout New South Wales. The walkout left almost 100 locomotives idle at the Broadmeadow yard alone. The chocks driven home with a resolve that they'll not be removed until the drivers get what they want. That is, the abandonment by the SRA of plans to do away with the observer position on the XPT high-speed services and to extend the idea eventually to all long-distance trains. Most passenger trains in the state already operate one man. Meanwhile, all commerce which depends on transportation by rail has ceased, and passengers have had to find alternatives or stay home. At least one Newcastle travel agent, Jay's, has organised charter buses to and from Sydney, but it's forced to adopt a low profile because of government licensing regulations. The train drivers are reinforcing their claims about lack of safety by distributing this pamphlet. It asks, can the Rand government afford another Granville, where a rail crash in January 1977 killed 83 people, and backs its argument with pictures of examples of poorly maintained track and equipment. Ironically, the strike by drivers has given SRA maintenance crews the chance to get some uninterrupted work done on repairing the very things complained of. This crew was working just near the Broadmeadow overpass this morning. The Adamstown meeting agreed with the other gatherings. They'll call for a national train stoppage and will not even consider meeting again until Monday. The AFULE's state executive representative this morning was Mr. Bruce Woods.
Members today have voted not to meet again until next Monday, same time and same place. They're also calling on a federal stoppage, which means there would be no trains throughout Australia.
So the men here are totally in agreement with the Sydney meeting and other meetings throughout the state?
My word, I've never seen them more determined to win an issue than this one.
When would a national stoppage take place then?
The Australian Council, the governing body of this union, would meet later on this week in Sydney, and I'm sure there would be total support from that body.
The stoppage, which was extended into a 24-hour strike, was part of a national protest against the rejection by employers of a new log of claims. The award package was first put by the BWIU in November and backed up by a series of bans and limitations. 6 weeks ago, the bans were lifted to allow negotiations and the union was hopeful the claims would be ratified. However, earlier this week, the employers flatly refused to come to the party and now the bans have been reimposed. According to the Assistant State Secretary of the BWIU, Mr. Don McDonald, there could be turmoil in the building industry.
Because the employers had withdrawn their offer of last week, designed to bring about restoration of our award values and stability in the industry, the workers decided to stay out for the rest of the day in protest, and they have carried resolutions asking the ACTU to call a tripartite conference of the government, the employers and the unions to get the offer restored, and that if the offer is not restored within 7 days, the workers will be recommencing the campaign of industrial action, which will include another general stoppage in Newcastle, as well as bans and other forms of industrial action. They also carried a resolution in support of the ACTU wage case, which starts today.
Andrew Cook & Sons and Frank Viggers & Company were two family companies established around the turn of the century. Viggers in Wickham and Cook's, where Civic Park now is. About 1903, they both moved to take up residence next door to each other in Union Street, Newcastle, where until 1966, they competed fiercely but friendly. In 1966, Alan Taylor's acquired Viggers and moved it to this site in Newcastle Road, Jesmond. 2 years later, Taylor's also bought Cook's and amalgamated it into Viggers Cook. And in 1976, the entire operation was moved to Jesmond. Now, Viggers Cook will cease to be as a trading name from midnight, and Timberco will take its place, with the whole lot owned by Borrell. One man who remembers a lot of this history firsthand is 65-year-old Bill Campbell, who started with Viggers as a boy of 15. Bill remembers the days of timber deliveries by horse and truck, but his 50 years in the industry will come to an end Friday week.
Those days it was all over-intensified, no mechanical means, anything big to be cut, any big sections, whistle would blow and everyone would have to come around and manhandle it into the saws and such as that, whereas nowadays it's all mechanical.
Which is easier?
Today, by far.
Do it now.
The Jesmond Timber Complex will be closed for stocktake tomorrow to allow the transaction to take place. The General Manager of Timberco, Mr. Rob Wild, explained that Jesmond will be the headquarters for the new statewide timber combine.
Timberco believes Newcastle to be the hub of New South Wales, if you like, but it certainly is, in terms of Timberco, we have branches established at Coffs Harbour, Fredericton, Singleton, Tamworth, Oberon, Dubbo, Albion Park and Maruya. And Newcastle, to our way of thinking, seemed the most likely and best place to set up the headquarters.